Right, so today we begin the chapter on slaves, sick persons, wedlock, and diverse other matters. We have three more topics to discuss today. This chapter discusses slavery, marriage, and other things. The next chapter is on warfare, and the last one is on religion. So I intend to finish Utopia today. So let us see how we can proceed, because I will have left only the month of February for teaching you two of Milton's essays. So we cannot go in a great detail now anymore. Your teaching time has been substantially reduced because of your semester examinations in March, I think. So on slavery, Robinson uses the term bondmen. They neither make bondmen of prisoners taken in battle, unless it be in battle that they fought themselves, nor of bondmen's children, not to be shot, of any such as they can get out of foreign countries, though he were there a bondman. So we notice that the Utopians do not take prisoners of war as slaves, which was the prevalent custom in classical times. Secondly, slavery is not inherited. So this is also a progressive measure compared to the classical times, and also in the Middle Ages, serfdom was inherited. So in these two respects, the Utopians are in a more progressive situation, or they have a more progressive attitude. We do not wonder that they have slavery, because slavery was well accepted a norm in the Renaissance. In England, it was acceptable, and as you may know that slave trade was rampant in the 16th and 17th centuries, when slaves from Africa, people from Africa, were taken by ship by slave traders to the New World or Americas and made slaves. And the English people profited a lot, and we have many even famous English authors who profited from slave trade. So considering that Moore is quite an early writer belonging to the early modern period when slavery was acceptable, so we do not wonder that he keeps slavery as a condition in Utopia also. But he distinguishes between the practice of slavery in Utopia from that of England or that of the classical period by indicating that slavery was not as rampant in Utopia as it was prevalent in the classical times. Prisoners of war were not made slaves, and slavery was not inherited. So who were made slaves? From their own country, those who were criminals or trespassed some laws, they were made slaves. And the slaves were made to work very hard, this kind of people, such as among themselves for heinous offenses be punished with bondage, or else such as in the cities of other lands for great trespasses be condemned to death. So those who committed great offense, they were made slaves, and they were made to work very hard. But then there was another kind of bondsman who would be very poor in his own country, and therefore he would apply for being a slave in Utopia. And such men were treated kindly in Utopia. These they entreat and order honestly, and entertain almost as gently as their own free citizens. saving, they put them to a little more labor. So they make a little distinction between slaves from other countries. I mean, only those who volunteer to become slaves in Utopia, and slaves from their own country. So they give a little more work to people from other countries. But normally, they do not make slaves from people from other countries. That is stated at the very beginning. Then comes the topic of sickness and euthanasia, which is very significant. The sick, they see to with great affection and let nothing at all pass concerning either physic or good diet, whereby they may be restored again to their health. So the sick are treated very well, and their diet is taken care of. They are given good diet. But the issue of euthanasia, that is voluntary acceptance of death, was practiced in Utopia. Unlike in England or in most countries in the Renaissance, euthanasia was not acceptable. Such as we speak of incurable diseases, they comfort with sitting by them, with talking with them, and to be short, with all manner of health that may be. But if the disease be not only incurable, but also full of continual pain and anguish, then the priests and the magistrates exhort the man, seeing he is not able to do any duty of life, and by overliving his own death is noisome and irksome to others and grievous to himself, that he will determine with himself no longer to cherish that pestilent and painful disease. So when somebody has a painful disease and he does not want to live any longer, and he does not do any good to himself or to others by living any longer, then in that case, they are allowed to choose death. And in so doing, they tell him he shall do wisely, seeing by his death he shall lose no commodity, but end his pain. And because in that act he shall follow the counsel of the priests, that is to say, of the interpretation of God's will and pleasure, they show him that he shall do like a godly and a virtuous man. Now this euthanasia, or committing suicide, voluntary death, it was acceptable in the classical times. When somebody had no other way of quitting honorably any situation, either it be military, diplomatic, or financial, or whatever, then in the classical times it was considered honorable to quit by suicide. We know that Seneca committed suicide. Suicide was very different in the classical times, unlike today, where we think that suicide is only some kind of, you know, mental disturbance which leads to commit suicide. But in the classical times, suicide was accepted as a common form of leaving the world, when one decided that one would rather quit honorably than live with infamy. They that be thus persuaded finish their lives willingly, either with hunger or else die in their sleep without any feeling of death. But the Utopians do not allow anybody to die against his will, nor they use no less diligence and attendance about him, believing this to be an honorable death. But otherwise, I mean in other situations, people are not normally allowed to commit suicide. Else he that killeth himself before that the priest and the council have allowed the cause of his death, him as unworthy either to be buried or with fire to be consumed, they cast unburied into some stinking marsh. So those who commit suicide or euthanasia without the permission of the priests and the magistrates, they are given a dishonorable treatment after death. Then we come to the question of marriage. The woman is not married before she be 18 years old. The man is 4 years older before he marry. So a man of 21 years and a woman of 18 years can marry in Utopia. These were the minimum ages of marriage. In this, Moore is showing Utopia a very progressive country, because in England at that time, the church allowed girls to marry at the age of 12 and boys at the age of 14. So considering that early marriage in the Renaissance, the marriage of 18 and 21 sound very modern. Like that is something we practice today. Almost it is similar to our practice in modern times. Premarital sex was not allowed in Utopia, and it was considered an offense. If either the man or the woman be proved to have actually offended before their marriage with another, the party that so hath trespassed is sharply punished, and both the offenders be forbidden ever after in the, all their life to marry, unless the fault be forgiven by the prince's pardon. So those who would be proved to have committed premarital sex or extramarital sex, they would be punished. And unless the prince forgives the person, he won't be allowed to marry in future. Furthermore, now we come to the question of choosing of partner, wife or husband. And here Moore suggests a very bizarre, you know, practice of the Utopians, that the persons who want to marry see each other in the naked before marriage. Furthermore, in choosing wives and husbands, they observe earnestly and straightly a custom which seemed to us very fond and foolish. For a sad and honest matron showeth the woman, be she maid or widow, naked to the wooer. And likewise, a sage and discreet man exhibited the wooer naked to the woman. At this custom we laughed and disallowed it as foolish. So deliberately, Moore is pointing out that how this practice goes against the norm of European civilization, and therefore it is a foolish practice among the Utopians. Then Hitrode goes on to explain the how the Utopians justify this practice. The Utopians say that when somebody would purchase a horse or any animal, he would insist on seeing the animal and inspecting the animal very thoroughly. All parts of the body of the animal will be examined thoroughly before the purchase will be made. And if we are so careful about purchasing a horse or an animal, then we should be much more careful when we are going to select a partner with whom we are going to live our entire lives. So the Utopians find it very strange that the whole body of the woman or the man is completely covered in clothes, so that no part can be inspected, and if there is any deformity, that cannot be found. Now the editor, editor George Logan, the other text that I am consulting, says that probably this was a suggestion that in the Renaissance, syphilis was very rampant, and this sexual disease being very infectious. Therefore, probably it was a hint that Europeans, should be cautious before choosing a marriage partner. Then, the practice of monogamy among the Utopians. And this word they constrained more earnestly to look upon, because they only of the nations in that part of the world be content every man with one wife apiece. So the Utopians took marriage very seriously and inspected their partner before marriage. This is further justified by the fact that they are monogamous. That is, the men are satisfied with only one wife. The language of Robinson is very, appears very comic to us. only one wife apiece, that is not more than one wife would be allowed every man. So therefore they would be more careful in choosing their partner. Now about the issue of inspecting or looking at the future partners naked, about that we learn that Plato in the Laws had written something similar. Plato wrote that the persons who are going to marry in future, they should be allowed to dance together naked, and everybody else should be very modest and humble when this is happening, by which I suppose Plato meant that even though it appears to be bizarre, people should take it seriously. They should not laugh or behave strangely. Therefore, Moore has, of course, we may say, an antecedent in this, in Plato. Now, monogamy is again, we see, a modern practice. By suggesting that only the Utopians practice this and all other nations, neighboring nations, did not practice it, I suppose Moore particularly alluded to the Asian nations or nations like Persia and others, because the Utopians were very close to the Persians in culture. So the practice of polygamy among other nations, Asian nations, was well known in Europe, and they considered this an evil practice because polygamy was not allowed by Christianity. So the Utopians are represented as practicing monogamy. And matrimony is there never broken but by death, except adultery break the bond, or else the intolerable wayward manners of either party. Moore says that divorce is not easy in Utopia. We will learn very soon that divorce was practiced in Utopia, but it is not very easy. That is, people cannot break their marriage bond unless one of them die or one of them practices adultery with another person. In those cases only there is a possibility of separation. If the husband abandons his wife without any reason, then he would be severely judged. For they judge it a great point of cruelty that anybody in their most need of help and comfort should be cast off and forsaken, and that old age, which both bringeth sickness with it and is a sickness itself, should unkindly and unfaithfully be dealt with. So the Utopians normally do not allow separation of husband and wife without any valid reason. But now and then it chances, whereas the man and the woman cannot well agree between themselves, both of them finding other with whom they hope to live more quietly and merrily, that they by the full consent of them both be divorced asunder and married again to other. So when marriage between two parties has become unbearable, they cannot live together anymore, then, and if both of the parties have also found other partners, then by mutual consent they can divorce and remarry. So here we have the clause of divorce, that they by full consent be divorced and married again to other, but that not without the authority of the council, which agreeth to no divorces before they and their wives have diligently tried and examined the matter. Yeah, and then also they be loath to consent to it, because they know this to be the next way to break love between man and wife, to be in easy hope of a new marriage. So the Utopians are very suspicious of any divorce proposal, and they are reluctant to grant it because they think that this is a way of having another marriage and indulging in sexual pleasure in an unauthorized way. So we see that this sounds very similar to the way marriage is looked upon today in modern society. It is made very difficult to divorce. But much more than in the West. Here, for example, under Hindu law of marriage, it is extremely difficult to divorce for any party. And if anybody wants to divorce, then one would have to wait for years and years, because the judges would grant them several opportunities of being mutually reconciled, and that would take years and years. So we see that the utopians are very conservative on the question of divorce. Breakers of wedlock be punished with most grievous bondage and so on. And then there would be punishment for adultery and other trespasses. Next, Moore says that they have singular delight and pleasure in fools. So the idea of the fool, particularly in a court, in a royal court, or in the court of a nobleman, was very common in Renaissance England. Even Sir Thomas More had in his family, in his household, a fool. So having a fool would suggest a kind of sophisticated culture in the Renaissance. The Utopians also took pleasure in fools. And on the question of fools, both Erasmus and More were interested. We know Erasmus wrote The Praise of Folly, where he makes folly the speaker, the principal speaker. And More also writes about fools, and in this book Utopia we find several reference to fools and representation or criticism of various kinds of people, to some extent similar to the manner Erasmus does in The Praise of Folly. And as it is a great reproach to do any of them hurt or injury, so they prohibit not to take pleasure of foolishness. For that they think doth much good to the fools. And if any man be so sad and stern that he cannot laugh neither at their words nor at their deeds, none of them be committed to his tuition, for fear lest he would not entreat them gently and favorably enough. So fools were allowed to be kept, but people who were generous were allowed to keep fools, but those who would not laugh, that is, who did not have a sense of humor, and therefore they would not treat the fools gently, they were not allowed to keep fools. They do not only fear their people from doing evil by punishments, but also allure them to virtue with rewards of honor. Therefore they set up in the marketplace the images of notable men and of such as have been great and bountiful benefactors to the commonwealth for the perpetual memory of their good acts. Well, so that is something we do even today. At every street corner we have a statue of Netaji, Tagore, or Vivekananda, or Ramakrishna. So we keep images of honorable men in the marketplace, so that people are stimulated to emulate them. I do not know how much that actually works. The Utopians also lure people towards virtue. That is, they try to stimulate people to practice virtue, and therefore they keep the images of such honorable men in public places. They have but few laws, for to people so instructed and instituted very few do suffice. So this is a point that More makes, that the Utopians have very few laws. And why? The reason is that educated people do not need many laws, because by virtue of their education and their training they behave lawfully, you know. Only those who cannot behave properly, they need a number of laws. Therefore, this is a model for More, that an ideal commonwealth should have few laws. And lawyers are criticized here also, as in Erasmus's Praise of Folly, because the lawyers, ideally there should be no lawyers in a country. If people follow laws very faithfully, then the lawyers should have no role. The lawyers only benefit or profit from the quarrels of others. Furthermore, they utterly exclude and banish all attorneys, proctors and surgeons at the law, which craftily handle matters and subtly dispute of the laws. For they think it most meet that every man should plead his own matter and tell the same tale before the judge that he would tell to his man of law. So shall there be no circumstance of less circumstance of words, and the truth shall sooner come to light. So everybody was allowed to plead for himself. Now that is practiced even today in modern societies. Anybody, if he or she wants, can plead her or his own case in a court of law. The judge would allow that. And Moore says that in that case there would be less word and the truth will come out. Which is a subtle dig or a subtle criticism of lawyers, that lawyers obfuscate the truth with more words than necessary. So the utopians are so virtuous that the neighboring countries, they sometimes borrow from them magistrates or rulers. Page 103, as touching leagues, which in other places between country and country be so oft concluded, broken and renewed, they never make none with any nation. So the practice of making treaties or forming leagues, this practice was so often flouted in the Renaissance, particularly the popes, and particularly Pope Alexander VI made treaties and easily flouted them, or made promises which he did not keep. And this was also observed in the practice of many rulers or magistrates in many countries. And therefore Moore suggests that in Utopia they do not, you know, make treaties or leagues. It is better not to have treaties or leagues than to make them and flout them. For here in Europe, and especially in these parts where the faith and religion of Christ reigneth, the majesty of leagues is everywhere esteemed holy and inviolable, partly through the justice and goodness of princes, and partly at the reverence and motion of the head of bishops. So in Europe, in treaties and leagues, the bishops and priests play a role, because they think that religion or religious people should have a role in matters of faith, because treaty is also a kind of faith. But in that newfound part of the world which is scarcely so far from us beyond the line equinoctial, as our life and manners be dissident from theirs, no trust nor confidence is in leagues. But the more and holier ceremonies the league is knit up with, the sooner it is broken by some cavillation found in words. So, ironically, Moore tells the opposite here. Moore writes that in Europe, people stick to their treaties because being Christians and with the involvement of priests, the treaties become a matter of faith for them. But in the new world, since they are not Christians, so they do not abide by the treaties, and therefore utopians altogether abhor making treaties. So anybody familiar with the history of Europe of that time would know that many rulers and popes did not abide by their treaties, violated the treaties very frequently, and that is why Moore suggests here that utopians do not make treaties. but actually he is not praising the Europeans for you know, abiding by their treaties. He is making an ironical statement here. All right, so any question on this chapter? Okay, so the next chapter is on battle or warfare. On this issue, Morse suggests that the Utopians do not usually engage in war, except in exceptional circumstances. But we have to take this assertion with caution, because in this matter also we do not find the Utopians to be as innocent or as virtuous as Moore proposes them to be. Now we see that the Utopians, they practice warfare or battle, not only men but also women, and therefore though they do daily practice and exercise themselves in the discipline of war, and not only the men but also the women upon certain appointed days, lest they should be to seek in the feat of arms if need should require, yet they never go to battle, but either in the defense of their own country or to drive out of their friend's land the enemies that have invaded it, or by their power to deliver from the yoke and bondage of tyranny some people that be therewith oppressed. So apparently the Utopians did not take part in war, but it appears that they are very battle worthy, and they would practice warfare all the time, and in situations where they felt that they should intervene, like if they saw that some neighboring country the ruler was oppressing the people, then they would intervene to free them of the tyrant, or to drive out from their friend's land enemies and so on. So we may say that they did not lack excuses for going to war. And we also know that earlier we have seen that they would grab the lands of people if the people do not use that land properly. So that is also another kind of, you know, violence, another kind of warfare. So they had many excuses for going to war. Then we see that the Utopians have another practice which is very questionable, that they hire mercenaries, and only in the last resort they would allow their own citizens to participate in war, because war is injurious, war is harmful, and people would die in battles, and they would protect their own citizens and would hire other people or other nations sometimes in warfare, which is a reflection of the practice of hiring Swiss soldiers in Europe in the Renaissance. The Swiss were available for fighting. They were professional soldiers, and many nations hired the Swiss mercenaries. And even today the Vatican, for example, the Pope's bodyguards, they are all Swiss. So this practice or this questionable practice is seen among the Utopians. And on the question, on the issue whether war should be fought or not, John Colet, another famous humanist contemporary with Moore, had written that in Christianity, no war can be supported in any circumstances. War is always an offense or a violation of religion, according to Christianity. But as we know that the Renaissance popes, they behaved like kings and emperors, like secular princes, and they would grab other countries, other people's lands, and therefore would often go to war. So this issue was often violated in the Renaissance. And we find a reflection of that in the practice of the Utopians also, where apparently they are peace-loving people and do not go to war without any cause. But as we see that there are exceptions or there are excuses for going to war. Moore gives an example of the Utopians fighting for the Nephilojets against the Allopolitans little before our time was made for any other cause, but that the Nephilojet merchantmen, as the Utopians thought, suffered wrong of the Allopolitans under the pretense of right. So when one nation oppressed another nation, and Moore invents these names which have satirical meanings, like all the Greek names used here in this book, they have satirical or pejorative or ironical meanings. Nephilojets means those who are born of clouds, and Allopolitans means a land of no people. So these fictitious nations, land of no people means a fictitious land. So these fictitious nations, they fought. Why? Because the Allopolitans or the merchant, the Allopolitans oppressed or cheated the merchants of the Nephilojets. So the Utopians fought on behalf of the Nephilojets. But whether it was right or wrong, it was with so cruel and mortal war revenge, the countries round about joining their help and power to the puissance and malice of both parties, that most flourishing and wealthy people, being some of them shrewdly shaken and some of them sharply beaten, the mischiefs were not finished nor ended, until the Allopolitans at the last were yielded up as bondmen into the jurisdiction of the Nephilojets. For the Utopians fought not this war for themselves, and yet the Nephilojets before the war, when the Allopolitans flourished in wealth, were nothing to be compared with them. So this is an example of the devastating effect or impact of war on a people or a nation. And Raphael here says that the Allopolitans, who were rich than the Nephilojets before the war, after the war they were all arrested, they were beaten, and they were taken prisoners and made slaves. So the entire condition of these people changed. And this war is described here as a very cruel and merciless war, where the Utopians took revenge on the Allopolitans. Therefore we see mention of a lot of violence in the practice of the Utopians. If any of their men is captured by another country, then they would not rest until they get the compensation for that. They be not only sorry but also ashamed to achieve the victory with bloodshed, counting it great folly to buy precious wares too dear. Now this paragraph contradicts the earlier example that Raphael gave of the Utopians fighting very violently and cruelly with the Allopolitans. Here Raphael says that they were ashamed of bloody wars or violent wars. And so they wanted to avoid bloodshed, and they tried to solve the chief point of dispute, if it could be achieved without war. Then they would not go into war. So Raphael says that they have this practice of sending notices or pasting notices in public places in the enemy country which they wanted to fight, that whoever would kill the prince would be given a huge reward. And because of that, the people of that country, they would all begin to suspect one another of being a spy. So it will create dissension and division among the enemy nation. Not only that, the utopians also would paste a notice that would announce double reward to anybody who would bring the prince alive, or the people who they wanted to kill. If they are brought alive as prisoners, then the reward would be double. So this kind of sending spies to another country, trying to break their morale, trying to divide them, making them suspicious of one another, this does not sound to be a very noble practice, which means that the utopians do not practice chivalric warfare. So their warfare is anti-chivalric, unlike the practice of European nations. And they often would buy out their enemies with gold and silver. So they would use the power of wealth rather than honor or valor for defeating their enemies. Then Raphael gives the example of the utopians hiring mercenaries. They mostly hired mercenaries from a nation called Zapolites, which was a barbarous nation, very strong, and they would fight very rudely and very ruthless. Now the utopians hired these people and sent them into battle and would offer them great reward if they came back. Now Raphael says that very few of them came back to claim the reward, because they would die. And it was the utopians' policy to send more of these people to war, to battles, so that they die. So we may say that it was a policy of genocide practiced by the utopians, that they wanted to kill off the barbaric nation of the Zapolites, because they were better killed than they would kept alive. They would be kept alive. So this practice of killing off a nation, even though not directly but through indirect means, by sending them to war, is nothing else than a genocide. If they win the field, they persecute not their enemies with the violent rage of slaughter, page 111. For they had rather take them alive than kill them. Neither they do so follow the chase and pursuit of their enemies, but they leave behind them one part of their host in battle array under their standards. So they do not kill their defeated enemies. Then how they make their trenches, how they fortify their camp, what kind of armors they use. More says that they use an armor with which they can swim, which seems to be a very advanced technology, because the armor was very heavy. People could hardly move with their armor on. But to be able to swim with their armor on would be quite a novel technology. Truce taken with their enemies for a short time, they do so firmly and faithfully keep, that they will not break it. So even though their general practice is not to make treaties with anybody, but they would have temporary truce, and they would honor them very well. Right. So as we see that the chapter on battles, on warfare, is in great detail. Similarly, marriage was discussed in great detail in the earlier chapter. Marriage, adultery, divorce, and so on. So these are important questions which to answer which you would have to read the text thoroughly. And we come to the final chapter of the religions in Utopia, which becomes an important issue in the context of the Reformation, because the Reformation was at hand. And More wrote on the request of Henry, More wrote tracts against Luther. So as a person who himself participated in the counter-reformation actions, we find this chapter is significant. There be diverse kinds of religions, not only in sundry parts of the island, but also in diverse places of every city. So the Ethiopians do not have one religion, unlike in Europe, where the whole nation has one religion. Either the nation is predominantly Roman Catholic, or it is predominantly Protestant. But both Roman Catholicism and Protestantism are actually different practices of Christianity. So, even though there may be people from other religions, the Western countries or the European countries, they were basically all Christian countries. There be diverse kinds of religion. In Ethiopia, the picture is different. Many religions are practiced. Some worship for God the sun, some the moon, some other of the planets. The worship of the sun and the worship of the planets was a very common practice among pagans. In most pagan cultures, the sun, the moon and the stars, you know, they were worshipped as gods. Even in our culture, in Indian culture, for example, the sun is worshipped in the Vedas. The Gayatri Mantra is a worship of the sun. Then Rahu and Ketu are supposed to be planets who are also worshipped. And all other planets, Brihaspati, Shani, you know that these planets are all worshipped in the Indian system. So the Ethiopians, being pagans, they worship planets and stars. There be that give worship to a man that was once of excellent virtue or of famous glory, not only as God but also as the chiefest and highest God. So this practice of worshipping a holy man as God, that is also very common among pagans. So we see here in India, there is no dearth of holy men who are worshipped as gurus by many people. Now, why does Moore mention these? Because in Christianity, the concept of worshipping any man is abominable. Because only God can be worshipped, and only Christ, who is believed to be the Son of God, can be worshipped. Howbeit they all begin by little and little to forsake and fall from this variety of superstitions, and to agree together in that religion which seemeth by reason to pass and excel the residue. And it is not to be doubted, but all the other would long ago have been abolished. So Raphael says that even though these people had many religions, which from a Christian point of view are many superstitions, because the Christians think that only their religion is religion, all other religions are superstition. So Raphael says that gradually the Ethiopians were acknowledging the fact that their religions were superstition, and when they heard about Christianity and about Christ from Raphael, then they were inclined to follow his path. But after they heard us speak of the name of Christ, of his doctrine, laws, miracles, and of the no less wonderful constancy of so many martyrs whose blood willingly shed brought a great number of nations throughout all parts of the world into their sect, you will not believe with how glad minds they agreed unto the same, whether it were by the secret inspiration of God, or else for that they thought it nighest unto that opinion which among them is counted the chiefest. So they thought that the Christian religion is very close to their most principal religion. But because among us four, there was no priest, which I am rightly sorry for, they being entered and instructed in all other points of our religion, lack only those sacraments which here none but priests do minister. So in the Renaissance, all Christian sacraments, excepting marriage, were performed by priests. So, therefore, Raphael says that since there were no priest among them, so they could not baptize them. So baptism is something which must be practiced by a priest. Of the seven Catholic sacraments, only baptism and matrimony can be conferred without a priest. Okay, so Raphael says, so though they receive the other sacraments, they still lack those which in our religion can be administered only by priests. Okay, so we may assume that Raphael then baptized the priests, baptized the utopians. So whatever, the issue here is that Raphael and his men, they tried their best to bring utopians to the practice of Christianity, and apparently they were successful, as many of them thought that Christian religion was quite close to their principal religion. Verily, however, it came to pass, many of them consented together in our religion and were washed in the holy water of baptism. So, here it is quite clearly stated that Raphael and others, they baptized some of the utopians. The issue of religious tolerance is the next important issue. The utopians practiced religious tolerance, as we already saw that many religions were practiced in their country. They also which do not agree to Christ's religion fear no man from it, nor speak against any man that hath received it, saving that one of our company was sharply punished. He, as soon as was baptized, began against our wills with more earnest affection than wisdom to reason of Christ's religion, and began to work so hot in his matter that he did not only prefer our religion before all others, but also did utterly despise and condemn all others, calling them profane. So one of the newly baptized became an ardent Christian and started calling every other religion practiced in the country as profane. So here I suppose more is hinting at the fanaticism which could often be seen among Christians. So even though religious tolerance was not practiced in Europe, basically, before Elizabeth I, there was a lot of religious persecution, both in the time of Henry VIII and in the time of Mary. Mary was notorious for persecuting the Protestants, and Edward was a wise prince, but he lived for a very short period as a king. So, Elizabeth brought the practice of religious tolerance as a policy, but mostly in Europe religious tolerance was never practiced, and as a result we know, particularly in France, we know of the communal riots between Roman Catholics and Protestants, and many men died in these riots. So even though this book comes a little earlier than all those communal riots, but it is prescient and more suggests that religious tolerance should be practiced here in this book. But as a man of action, as a policy maker, as a courtier, we know that More wrote a tract against heresy and was himself instrumental in pursuing, arresting and punishing many heretics in England. So whatever More may have written here or suggested here, that would not conform to his practice because he was, we may say, an ardent Roman Catholic, and he persecuted many Protestants. For this is one of the ancientest laws among them, that no man shall be blamed for reasoning in the maintenance of his own religion. So this ancientest law is the law of religious tolerance, that no man must be stopped from preaching his own religion or practicing his own religion. And then we have a prehistory once again, before King Eutropus came and conquered this country. When he came, he found that he could win because the people were religious, were divided in religion. And therefore probably he exploited this division among people on the question of religion, like the British exploited the religious divide among Indians between Hindus and Muslims. So whatever, King Eutropus could conquer the land because of this religious division. So here we have a kind of, you know, prescience that religious division among a nation would often lead to subjugation by other nations. But after Eutropus became the ruler, then he pursued a policy of religious tolerance and allowed everybody to practice his or her own religion. And this law King Eutropus made not only for the maintenance of peace, which he saw through continual contention and mortal hatred utterly extinguished, but also because he thought this decree should make for the furtherance of religion. So if people are allowed to practice their religion, then people would be more religious. So Eutropus took this decision. Then on the question of the immortality of souls, therefore all this matter he left undiscussed and gave to every man free liberty and choice to believe what he would, saving that he earnestly and straitly charged them that no man should conceive so vile and base an opinion of the dignity of man's nature as to think that the souls do die and perish with the body, or that the world runneth at all adventures governed by no divine providence. So the immortality of the soul was an ancient belief coming down from Plato and the Neoplatonics down to the Renaissance, and some Aristotelian philosophers opposed the idea of immortality of the soul, but it was considered to be a minority opinion, because as most rulers, Christian rulers and the popes, they were powerful and dominant, and therefore they would not allow this argument. The belief in immortality of the soul, and that one benevolent God was all-powerful, who ruled over this entire world. These two beliefs were kind of fundamental with Christianity. And Moore suggests that King Eutropus also made people believe in these two. The Utopians regard basic truths about immortality and divine providence as attainable by natural reason and as providing the only rational sanction for the life of virtue. Some ancient philosophers, particularly the Pythagoreans, as a facet of their doctrine of the transmigration of souls, held the same view. Okay, so the Greek philosophers, like the Pythagoreans, who believed in transmigration of souls, they also believed in the immortality of the soul. And they believed that people in their later births, they would take up on them, they would be born as animals or birds or in other animal forms according to their merit. So this whole idea of transmigration would not be possible unless one believed in the immortality of the soul. So here is an argument against transmigration of the soul. And therefore they believe that after this life vices be extremely punished and virtues bountifully rewarded. Him that is of a contrary opinion they count not in the number of men, as one that hath availed the high nature of his soul to the vileness of brute beasts' bodies, much less in the number of their citizens, whose laws and ordinances, if it were not for fear, he would nothing at all esteem. For you may be sure that he will study either with craft privily to mock, or else violently to break the common laws of his country, in whom remaineth no farther fear than of the laws, nor no farther hope than of the body. The idea here is that there were some vile men who did not believe in immortality of the soul, and therefore they were not afraid of punishment after death. So those who believe in the immortality of the soul also naturally believe in heaven and hell, that is punishment and reward after death. But those who do not believe in immortality of the soul think that punishment or reward, they are available only in this birth, only in this incarnation, and after the body dies, the soul also dies. So this was looked upon as a vile thought in Utopia. So such a person would be excluded from all offices and would be rejected from all common administration in the will public. So the Utopians punished people who did not believe in this faith of the immortality of the souls. So here I see that more represents the Utopians as similar to Christians, as he does in many aspects. He represents the Utopians as similar to Christians. There be also other, and of them no small number, which be not forbidden to speak their minds as grounding their opinion upon some reason, being in their living neither evil nor vicious. Here Raphael speaks about people who believed in transmigration of the soul. And these people were allowed to practice their religion, they were not punished by the state. Because unlike the heretics who did not believe in the immortality of the soul, these people who believed in transmigration of soul, they also believed in immortality of the soul. But the only difference is that these people believed that after death, people could be reborn in the shape of animal or birds, which the majority did not think, like the Christians do not think that people would be reborn as animals or birds. And therefore, these people, though they are in a religious minority, they were not punished for their belief. So, we may say that here we also find represented a gamut of Western philosophy, because the belief in immortality of the soul can be found among Platonists, Neoplatonists and Christians. The belief in transmigration of the soul can be found among Pythagoreans and others. So, different Western philosophies are represented here through the different religion or religious practices of the Utopians. So, the Utopians, they believe that man would experience bliss as a reward after death, and therefore they do not mourn the death of people. Contrarywise, all that depart merely and full of good hope, for them no man mourneth, but followeth the hearse with joyful singing, commending the souls to God with great affection. And at the last, not with mourning sorrow, but with a great reverence, they burn the bodies. And in the same place, they set up a pillar of stone with the dead man's titles there engraved. When they be come home, They rehearse his virtuous manners and his good deeds, but no part of his life is so oft or gladly talked of as his merry death. So here the utopian's practice depart from that of the Christians, because we know that Christians mourn the death of people, and the utopians, they do not mourn the death of people. Now Raphael makes the utopians not mourning the death of people to be very reasonable, because if people go to heaven after their death, then they should not mourn, rather they should rejoice. But this is not the practice in Christianity. And Raphael says that the utopians burn their bodies. Now on this issue, we know that the Christians, they practice burying the body, and cremation of the body among Christians was not practiced before the 19th century. So even today, some Christians may cremate their bodies occasionally, but that was not permissible before the 19th century. Whereas the utopians cremate the bodies of their dead, like many pagans. They utterly despise and mock soothsaying and divination of things to come by the light of voices of birds and all other divinations or vain superstitions, which in other countries be in great observation. Augury, that is interpretation of the voices of birds, which was an ancient pagan practice, which is in some form present in India also. So this was despised by the utopians. Then the utopians, they value contemplation of nature and praise thereof coming is to God a very acceptable honor. Contemplation and praise of nature. Yet there be many so earnestly bent and affection to religion that they pass nothing for learning, nor give their minds to any knowledge of things, but idleness they utterly forsake and eschew, thinking felicity after this life to be gotten and obtained by busy labors. So they value labor, they value work, even though they live only contemplative life. So here also we see that the utopians are divided. Some of them practice active life, others practice contemplative life. And this reminds us of the Renaissance debate between Vita Activa and Vita Contemplativa. So, even though they think that contemplation of nature is good, their emphasis on work or labor or on active life is, we may say, in contradiction. But we know that the Renaissance ideal was the blend of contemplative life and active life. Therefore, I suppose Moore would expect that his readers won't see any contradiction in these two, because of the Renaissance ideal that contemplative and active life should go together, which the utopians are represented as practicing. Now, the utopians may be divided into two sects: those who are celibates or abstain not only from sex but also from eating meat, and some from any sort of animal food. So the ascetics or vegetarians, they are one group. The other group, they marry. So one group practices celibacy, vegetarianism and so on, asceticism, and the other group, they marry, they eat meat, they don't despise the comforts of marriage, but think that as they owe nature to their labor, so they owe children to their country. They eat meat precisely because they think it makes them stronger for any sort of heavy work. Such then are the people whom in their own language they call Buthreskas, a term which can be translated as the religious. Buthreskas is another Greek compound translated in the text, that is, the religious. The constant labor of these ascetics, often on disagreeable and painful tasks, contrast with the sloth Hithlode had previously attributed to the great lazy gang of priests and so-called religious. So earlier, Raphael had spoken of the priests and religious people as lazy, not working. But here we see that these people are represented as hard-working, even though they are religious people. So these are contradictions in the text. Then what kind of priests are used by the Utopians? And the priests, unless they be women, for that kind is not excluded from priesthood, how white few be chosen, and none but widows and old women, the men priests. So here Raphael says that in Utopia even women are chosen priests, even though the number may be very small. Most priests are men, but some women are chosen as priests. But in Christian Europe, women were not allowed to be priests till very recent times. The priests hold a very high position in society, and they marry the chiefest women of the country. For to no office among the Utopians is more honor and preeminence given. So the priest's office is very honorable, but the priests do not practice celibacy. So on the question whether priests should marry or not, there was a debate among the Catholics and the Protestants. So I suppose more represents the Protestant view here among the Utopians. And I suppose he wants the Utopian view to be strange and bizarre in some respects. And therefore, their practices would deviate from those of the Christians. They avoid idolatry or idol worship, page 122. Therefore, no image of any god is seen in the church. To the intent it may be free for every man to conceive God by their religion, after what likeness and similitude they will. So every man is free to conceive of God in any religion according to any likeness or similitude. So at the outset it seems that the Utopians' practice of not worshipping idols is the same as that of the Christians, but it is not, because no idol is kept in the church only because they can imagine God in any shape, which is very opposite, diametrically opposite from that of the Christian view. They kill no living beast in sacrifice, nor they think not that the merciful clemency of God hath delight in blood and slaughter, which hath given life to beasts to the intent they should live. They burn frankincense and other sweet savours, and light also a great number of wax candles and tapers, not supposing this gear to be anything available to the divine nature, as neither the prayers of men. But this unhurtful and harmless kind of worship pleaseth them. So the Utopians, they do not sacrifice animals to their gods. And in this, they appear to be similar to the Christians. And their using of frankincense and wax candles is also similar to the practice of the Roman Catholics. But unlike the Roman Catholics, they do not believe that the gods enjoy this, the smell or the aroma of these things. But they know that they do this because it is pleasant to them. This kind of worship is pleasant to them. So their worship is less of a superstition because they are conscious about their practice. Then their how they worship, it seems to be almost similar to the practice of the Christian Mass, how they sit together, how they worship together, and so on. Page 125, bottom of page 125. Contrarywise, there where all things be common to every man, it is not to be doubted that any man shall lack anything. So talking about the communism practiced in Utopia. For what can be, and though no man have anything, yet every man is rich. For what can be more rich than to live joyfully and merrily, without all grief and pensiveness, not caring for his own living, nor vexed or troubled with his wife's importunate complaints, nor dreading poverty to his son, nor sorrowing for his daughter's dowry. So they do not have the worries of citizens of other countries, because the state takes care of all these worries. So communism, how it is practiced among them and what are the benefits and all that is discussed here. Page 128. And I doubt not that either the respect of every man's private commodity or else the authority of our Savior Christ would have brought all the world long ago into the laws of this will public, if it were not that only one beast, the princess and mother of all mischief, pride, doth withstand and let it. So Raphael says that all countries would have followed the Utopians unless we had pride, which is our chief sin, because of which we cannot see the virtue of their practice. Foreseeing the chief causes of ambition and sedition with other vices, we plucked up by the roots and abandoned at home, there can be no jeopardy of domestic dissension, which alone hath cast underfoot and brought to naught the well-fortified and strongly defended wealth and riches of many cities. So, even though there may be no sedition or ambition of people may be under control, but there might be domestic dissension, and this often would lead to civil disobedience and lack of happiness among us. Okay, so the Utopia, the discourse by Raphael ends the second book, and with that we come to the end of the book. Now I have given you the questions on Utopia, which are very straightforward. I don't think that I will have time to discuss these questions, but if you have followed my lecture, then I suppose you would be able to answer them. So the first one is on Utopian's view of war, which we studied today. The debate on court employment through Raphael's reluctance, that is the debate between vita contemplativa and vita activa, which also has a reflection on Moore's personal choice. The function of the first book of Utopia, it is basically a debate and discussion of several topics before the launch of the description of the practice and manners of the Utopians. So the first book prepares us, where there are mentions of many different nations, it prepares us to confront or to experience the other in Utopia or in the Utopians, because their practices are very different from that of the Christians. The title of Utopia, so Utopia carries a pun in Greek language. When it is spelled with U, it means no place. When it is spelled with EU, Utopia, it means a happy place. So more deliberately creates an irony and ambiguity in the title, because there is no place in the world which is a happy place. So whether Utopia or Utopia, both are absent from this world, and therefore we can look at Utopia either as a happy place or as a dystopia, that is a place of no happiness. Significance of the discussion of thieves and vagabonds. It is a social criticism, criticism of the English laws and its treatment of the poor. Political thesis of the state on Utopia. Now, Utopia, whether it is democracy, communism or republic, Now all these three forms can be seen in Utopia. So it is a clever blend of democracy, communism and republicanism. Utopia is not just travel literature but is genre in itself. You have to speak about the utopian genre of writing. Utopian view on religion is the same, if not why it is more present in this work. It is of course not the same, that is not Roman Catholic view, but more presents here the utopian practices of religion, sometimes as similar to Roman Catholicism, at other times deviating from Roman Catholicism, so that it holds a mirror to the practice of Roman Catholicism in contemporary England and Europe. And thereby it would be Moore's contribution to the discussion of Reformation or Reformation issues in an indirect manner. These marriage, divorce, gold, administration, slavery, so short notes, you will be able to write them. Alright, so I stop here. If you have any question, you can...